Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of Session 6 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I would like to remind everyone present to switch your mobile phones to silent. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private? Right, thank you. Under agenda item number 2, we are taking evidence from John Swinney, MSP, the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, on two SSIs deferred from last week's meeting. These SSIs are SSI 2022-40, the Coronavirus Act 2020, Alteration of Expiry Date, Scotland Regulations 2022, and the Draft Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions, Directions by Local Authorities, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. The first of these SSIs is made affirmative and the second is an affirmative. Mr Swinney is accompanied by two Scottish Government officials, Elizabeth Blair, the Unit Head of COVID Coordination, and Graeme Fisher, the Deputy Director of the Directorate for Legal Services. May I welcome you all to the meeting this morning. As the Deputy First Minister knows, this is a chance for members to ask questions on the two instruments that deferred from last week. This committee is obviously focused on whether the instruments are correct as a matter of law, including whether the correct procedure has been applied, while the COVID-19 Recovery Committee will focus on the wider policy issues. It's likely to take evidence on these instruments on Thursday, the 17th of March. And with that, I'd like to invite the Deputy First Minister to make any opening remarks. Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I welcome the opportunity to address any points that the committee may have on the two sets of regulations on today's agenda. Firstly, on the Coronavirus Act 2020 Alteration of Expiry Date Scotland Regulations 2022, these regulations will amend the date on which five provisions in the United Kingdom Coronavirus Act would automatically expire from the 24th of March to the 24th of September 2022. By changing the expiry date of these powers, this will ensure that ministers have these powers available if and only if their use is needed in relation to coronavirus over the coming months. Secondly, the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. Similarly, these amend the date on which the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland Regulations 2020 would automatically expire from the 25th of March 2022 to the 24th of September 2022. Again, by changing the expiry date of these regulations, this will ensure that we keep in place important powers for local authorities to be able to make directions to control local outbreaks of coronavirus. The alteration of expiry regulations were made using the made affirmative procedure, and I'm aware that this is one of the issues raised by the committee. I've emphasised previously that the made affirmative procedure is an unusual power granted by Parliament in those situations when action may need to be taken more quickly than the normal affirmative procedure allows for. If this procedure were not available, there would be a risk that necessary measures could not be brought in quickly enough. The alteration of expiry date regulations are following the made affirmative procedure in this instance because at the time of laying, our understanding was that this was the only procedure available to us. As the committee is aware, it has since come to our attention that it would, in fact, have been possible to use the affirmative procedure. I would like to be clear, though, that even though the made affirmative procedure has been used here, we have nevertheless ensured that Parliament has 40 days for scrutiny of these regulations prior to them coming into force on the 24th of March 2022, as would have been the case under the affirmative procedure. As for the procedure for the regulations extending the expiry date of the Local Authority Directions regulations, these were laid in draft and are following the affirmative procedure with an expedited timetable. Both of these sets of regulations put back the date on which the key coronavirus provisions would have expired by default, and these regulations, and thus the regulations that protect our ability to be able to put in place any measures that may be considered necessary. We cannot let our capacity to have the measures expire by default because we may still need them. It is our intention and expectation that we'll lift the face covering requirements and the other remaining baseline measures with effect from the 21st of March. However, that is dependent on the course of the epidemic between now and then. But even after baseline measures are lifted, COVID will not have gone away and may have further surprises in store for us. As the strategic framework update states, we cannot rule out the possibility that it may be necessary to impose legal measures once more. We must therefore be ready and be able to respond effectively and it is essential that we have the powers to enable us to do so. In conclusion, both of these sets of regulations are essential to ensure that the right powers are available to manage COVID in this next phase of the pandemic, should that approach be required. And I'm happy to address any points from the committee.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. I'm going to open up questions and I'll hand over to colleagues. So just on the first of the regulations that they made affirmative, one of the sections there is section 38.2 and part 2 of Schedule 17. It's the powers of Scottish ministers to give educational and continuity directions relating to the continuity of education and childcare. That particular section, is that something that was utilised greatly over the course of the last, since the Act came into being, but also in terms of going forward with the next 6 months with this extension? Is it something that you would anticipate these powers would be utilised?
The powers were certainly used on what I would consider to be a regular basis during the course of the pandemic, both in respect of the requirements that we expected to be in place to be observed to maintain public health in the educational community. So at times they were used to essentially specify what could and could not happen within schools. So at the height of the pandemic, the educational continuity regulations were used to specify that, for example, children of key workers could be educated within schools or supported within schools, whereas other children could not. And then obviously they were used to specify our expectations about educational provision at times as well. So they certainly have been used over the course of the pandemic. As to whether they would need to be used for the foreseeable future, obviously they can only be used where there is a public health imperative to enable them to be so. But I think their existence and their significance relates to the fact that we must have, in my view, a statute book that is capable of enabling us to address the circumstances as we have to face them.
Certainly as we progress this year, if it was recognised that, that particular power and powers obviously in this instrument, if they weren't needed, would the Scottish Government be considering bringing forward regulations to remove these powers?
That would not be our intention, Convener. As the committee will be familiar, the government has brought forward primary legislation which aims to ensure that the statute book is equipped to deal with the uncertainties that we may have to face on an ongoing basis. And that's a separate issue which will be the subject of detailed and familiar parliamentary scrutiny. But the whole point of the extension of the legislation that is before the committee is to enable the government to be able to respond to the emerging situation that we face. Now, we don't, obviously, I've been expressly clear with Parliament before that we hope we don't have to face these situations, but we have to be equipped. The statute book has to be equipped should we face those circumstances.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. Mr Simpson.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Convener, and thanks for coming, Mr Swinney. I just want to start off, if I can, on this business about made affirmative versus affirmative, just so that it's on the record. And I'm talking about the instrument Coronavirus Act 2020 regulation. It's number 40. So it was laid as a made affirmative, and I think government has now accepted, although it didn't accept at the start, that you could have used the affirmative procedure. Now, in reality, it doesn't make any practical difference because of the timescale that you've allowed, but you do accept that you could have used the affirmative procedure. That's
good. As a consequence of helpful engagement with the lawyers of this committee, the government's the routine dialogue that goes on between lawyers, We have accepted that we could have used the affirmative procedure as opposed to the made affirmative, but we only brought it forward under the made affirmative because, in our view, that was the only provision that was available for us to do so.
Yes, but that was, in fact, incorrect.
Well, I think we've got to be careful about the use of the words correct and incorrect when we're talking about legal debate, because legal debate is at the heart of reconciling different views and interpretations of legislation. Indeed, the courts spend a large amount of time debating the words that we all put on the record in this institution to determine what is the correct interpretation of law. So there is a debate about the interpretation of parts of the provision in which the lawyers of this committee have put a position to the government's lawyers, which we have accepted.
Okay. I thought it would be useful if we just went through this instrument, because it contains a number of provisions, and I think it would be useful if we hear your thoughts on each of them. I might not cover them all, convener, but if I just go through them quickly, and I think some of them are quite straightforward. So the first one is relates to registration of deaths and stillbirths. And I think the ability to register those remotely. Is that something that's a choice for people? With this provision in place, does it have to be done remotely, or can people pop into an office still and register it in person?
They can register in person.
They
yes.
can. So this just gives people the option to register a death remotely.
Correct.
Right. Which actually sounds eminently sensible. It might be something that you want to keep in perpetuity.
That's why I'm legislating for it in the Substantive Act.
Okay.
Which is why I think the Act is so necessary.
Right. So the next one is vaccination and immunisation. And this allows people to be vaccinated or immunised against, it actually says in the policy note, any disease, not just COVID. And that can be delivered by somebody who's not a medical practitioner. So I just wondered, on the record, if you could just explain the practicalities around that.
That's about ensuring that we can have a broader range. It's actually the issue is about essentially who can administer the vaccine, and it's about ensuring that we have the broadest possible definition, because normally our vaccination programmes do not need to be as comprehensive as the ones we have just gone through successively and which we are likely to continue to have to go through for some time. So it is about broadening the pool of people who by law are able to exercise that, to undertake that task, which wouldn't be render the vaccination programme impractical to all intents and purposes if we didn't have that statute in place.
Yeah, because if we get into the sort of mass vaccination scenario which we've had, obviously there needs to be that kind of flexibility.
I think there is an interesting and important point in here, which is about the recognition that in these type of situations we are dealing with a challenge of a greater magnitude. So I don't have all the authoritative knowledge on the scale of all vaccination programmes, but I would think the flu vaccination programme is probably the biggest vaccination programme that takes place in the most concentrated period of time. Normally, childhood vaccinations are going on, but they're spread over the whole year and all the rest of it. But The COVID vaccination programme has, as we all know, been of a completely different character. So it was to provide that capacity that we were able to do so.
Okay, that's very useful. So if we can move on to the next section then, and this relates to educational institutions and childcare premises. Again, reading from your policy note, to date, I'm just reading from it, to date the power to give educational closure directions has not been used. It's considered unnecessary to extend this power in addition to the power to give educational continuity directions. So that's fine, you don't want that. But what you do want is powers to close boarding accommodation and student accommodation. So can you explain why you feel you need those powers?
For the reasons of public health, because in certain circumstances we may need to take decisions which relate to the prevalence of the virus and its presence in certain scenarios.
And yet, you haven't used those powers.
But I think this is a point we're going to, I think, repeatedly come back to, which is about whether or not the statute book should be equipped with the ability to help us to manage a situation that we may have to manage. And just because it's not, if we take the argument that's been put to me, that we should only act on the basis of precedent, then we would never change the statute book about COVID because we had never experienced COVID of the magnitude that we face.
But these are emergency powers, the emergency powers that were put in place for a variety of reasons, and yet in this case, you've never used those powers, you've relied on guidance. So I can't see why you would require to hang on to powers that you've never used throughout the pandemic.
But we may face a situation where we have to act, and we've got to act to protect public health. And this is the whole, this is a point that we're going to continually rub up against, as to whether or not the statute, and it will affect the longer-term legislation that Parliament considers, do we consider it necessary to have, with the benefit of our experience of handling the pandemic, a range of powers at our disposal which would enable us to deal with particular scenarios that we may face? And that's the question that Parliament has got to resolve. And as I have said again to Parliament on many occasions before, these things can happen extraordinarily quickly.
But I'll just come back on this point. You're asking for an extra 6 months for a power that you have never used. And during a pandemic, at times it's been pretty hairy and scary for people. Not so much now, thankfully. But you want to hang on to powers that have never been used. You've relied on guidance. I haven't heard a justification for that.
I'm offering the justification, convener, and to the extent that I'll end up repeating myself again and again, I've given the justification that I'm going to give to the committee.
I wouldn't wish you to repeat yourself. Convener, one more question if I can. So I've an issue with that particular one. The earlier ones we've discussed, I personally can see the validity in those. Have you considered, or would you consider, splitting this instrument up so that parliamentarians who would feel able to support some of it but not all of it would be able to do so?
I think that comes into the nature of the way in which we formulate legislation, and the questions that Mr. Simpson has raised about the earlier sections on registration of deaths and stillbirths and the vaccination and immunisation points, these will be essentially These are the type of standalone provisions in the ongoing legislation which members of Parliament can, you know, amend, adjust, you know, and as Mr. Simpson knows, I take a very open mind about the amendment of legislation. So, you know, there'll be space for engagement with those questions. When it comes to regulations, Parliament is offered the choice as to whether Parliament is able to accept or reject the instruments. Now, I haven't given consideration to separating the instruments, but and that opportunity doesn't arise because of the timescales in which we are now operating. But what the point I would make is that we have already expired very significant numbers of powers, and we've done that openly and clearly to Parliament when we have judged that there was no compelling reason for us to continue with those powers. That's obviously been the subject of scrutiny by this committee and support from Parliament.
I'm not really sure whether that was a yes or no. I think it was a no. Convener, I haven't touched on the local authorities instrument. If somebody else wants to pick up on that, that's fine, but I'm happy to ask about that if you want.
We'll get other colleagues first, and then take from there.
Thank you.
Mr. Hoy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Swinney. If I could just open perhaps with a slightly wider question that relates to two of the instruments that are before us today. In a parliamentary debate last September, you said that the government was committed to removing regulations when they were no longer necessary. And you said, and I quote, that regulations and restrictions have been removed when the situation has improved. And you've acknowledged that today about the expiry of many of the restrictions and regulations. However, you are at a point in time where the situation has markedly improved, still seeking the extension of many of these powers, for example, to reduce prisoners early. And your justification for that is that you believe that these powers are still necessary and proportionate. Could you just perhaps say a little bit about how you make that assessment about whether or not something is necessary and proportionate? And this has changed over time.
Well, that is the subject of a regular process of review, which ultimately involves Cabinet decisions and the statements that the First Minister has made to Parliament on a regular basis. The process involves analytical work that's undertaken within government to consider a whole range of different perspectives on the state of the pandemic, its seriousness, its level of threat to public health. That is that essentially leads to the production of the state of the epidemic report, which is published on a regular basis, publicly available. And that is then considered by a group which explores at senior level within government what we've described, which the committee's members of the committee will have heard me talking about before, the four harms, looking at the direct COVID health harm, the non-COVID health harm, the social and economic harm that is caused by COVID, and ultimately a judgment made by that group, which is populated by the chief advisers to the government, so the chief economist, the chief social policy advisor, chief medical officer, chief scientific advisor, chief educational officer, chief social worker. All these individuals consider that material and provide advice to Cabinet, which makes a judgment about whether or not regulations are proportionate. Now, that is ultimately a judgment. Government was explicit in the strategic framework update last Tuesday that is, always has been, always will be a judgment. But ministers, because we recognise, and this is entirely appropriate, that all of our decisions are justiciable, that we must be satisfied that such a stance of being proportionate could withstand legal challenge should that happen. And of course, the government takes those issues very seriously in its deliberations. It ultimately leads to a set of decisions that Cabinet takes and which are then reported to Parliament. And accordingly, if there's legislative measures that flow from that, they are brought before Parliament in the fashion with which the committee will be familiar.
Thank you for a full answer. Obviously, they have to be necessary, they have to be proportionate, they also have to be legal. And last week we considered, and again this week we'll consider measures in relation to COVID passports, thankfully the expiration of the present system of COVID passports. But last week we discussed another potentially contentious SSI, the Health Protections Number 4 extension regulations, which gives you the powers to maintain the wearing of face masks and reintroduce COVID passports at some point in the future. And on the latter issue, I'd like to ask you to reflect on evidence given to this committee by the government's business manager, Mr. Adam, who told the committee that COVID passports were compliant with GDPR and that your government, and I quote, wouldn't do anything illegal. Now that we know that the Information Commissioner warned ministers that the plan was unlawful, would you like to take the opportunity to correct the record? And could you say when the Information Commissioner's concerns were first made to you?
Well, certainly my reading of the Information Commissioner's a communication with the government would indicate to me that the issues the government has to address are about explaining the approach that's been taken to information handling. It wasn't the information handling that was the issue. It was our explanation of the remedial action the government's got to take, is to better explain the basis to members of the public of why their information has been handled in the way it's been handled. It's not the means of handling of the information. In terms of my knowledge of the situation, I became aware of the ICO's concerns on, I think, around about the 28th or the 29th of September. I'd have to verify exactly which day it was, but it was one of those 2 days.
Wouldn't it have been better if you'd made the public aware of those concerns at that stage?
Well, I've obviously got to make a lot of judgments about the merits of particular stances to take, and my judgment, having heard the issues that were on the minds of the Information Commissioner's team, that and given the necessity of ensuring that we had in place an accessible COVID certification scheme for members of the public, because I would remind Mr. Hoy that this was important not just for domestic certification but for international certification as well, that the appropriate course of action was to launch the app when we launched the app, as we had indicated would be the case.
And just finally, just in relation to that, obviously I welcome the fact that the instrument we considered this morning withdraws the scheme. If the scheme was to come back in its present form, would it now be compliant with GDPR legislation?
Well, Mr. Hoy will be aware of the contents of the Information Commissioner's letter to us of last week, and obviously the government will take all the steps necessary to ensure that we address those issues. But they are, as I stress, about the information that is, or the explanation that's given to the public about the basis in which the information has been handled and the way it's been handled.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I thank the Deputy Vice Minister for his comments so far. I think I'd rather zoom out from the specifics of this SSI, because I think I don't have any contention with the content of it. But I think perhaps bearing in mind the report published by the committee recently and the debate we had in the chamber last week, I think it was. I struggle to keep track of time at the moment. It's like my fast-moving events. But I think bearing that in mind, it's clear to me that obviously the government had to address the architecture that was facing it at the time of the pandemic, and however imperfect that architecture might have been, I think it's clear that in reflection, the system of made affirmative, affirmative might not be perfect and best suited to current legislative measures, and perhaps even reflecting on how best the Parliament might be involved in that process. Could there be, in the spirit of continuous improvement, a way of actually piloting, just reflecting on this particular SSI, but maybe going forward, looking at a way of using one of these procedures to actually pilot an expedited affirmative procedure, as a way of actually trying to flesh out exactly in practical terms what that might look like, You know, I think we've already heard from the debate that people would be happy to adapt to meeting irregularly in order to meet the time scales demanded of the situation, etc. That perhaps, given the fact that the Parliament's able to meet virtually or in a hybrid format, helps to move that practicality forward. So just in principle, invite the Deputy First Minister back to reflect on that dispute that's emerged about made affirmative versus affirmative being the most appropriate mechanism, and whether a new structure could be designed, and perhaps looking at how we actually now start that process in a practical way.
These are fundamentally issues for Parliament, but obviously I recognise the government has got a significant contribution to make to that discussion. So the government would engage willingly and positively in that discussion. I recognise, you know, I've been a parliamentarian now for just short of a quarter of a century, and I've always recognised the importance of parliamentary scrutiny, effective parliamentary scrutiny of all business of government, whether that's in questioning or whether that's in regulations or in legislation. But, you know, our parliamentary system has been tested by a very serious public health threat, which required us to move in the fashion. One of the observations I would have on the debate last week was a number of comments were made about the fact that the made affirmative procedure had, and I paraphrase here, hardly been used at all before 2020, and then had been used, you know, a bit like number 9 buses, although there was 130 of them or something at the one time. My simple point with that is, well, we hadn't had a pandemic before 2020. So Parliament's procedures were tested by the need to move quickly and sharply. Having said that, however, there's a lot of days between 0 and 40. So if there's, to put it rather crudely, if there's a way of getting us closer to the 0 days, but which gives Parliament the opportunity to scrutinise legislation, but equally allows the government to get on with the measures which are necessary to protect public health, the government will be very happy to engage in that discussion. So I think there is space for that to happen, for us to... it's difficult to perhaps pilot, because we have, you know, we all need to know on what basis are we bringing forward regulations. And as things stand just now, we have made affirmative, we have affirmative, and we have negative instruments. If we are going to consider expedited procedures, then I'm very happy to engage in that process.
Thank you for that. Just to put on the record that the COVID number 4 regulations that we did discuss at the committee last week were actually one of those examples of the expedited affirmative procedure, which is certainly unusual for our committee to undertake also. But also just to kind of make everyone aware that the discussions routine, obviously our officials, the government officials and the parliamentary officials, regarding the procedures available to this committee, those discussions are underway, and obviously we will have get more feedback in due course. Is it on this particular issue, or is going to bring in Bill Kidd?
Bring
in the other instrument. Okay, no problem. Okay, Bill.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener. Thank you very much, DFM. I know that you, from what you've been saying and from what I've heard you saying before, you recognise and appreciate the procedural imperatives that this committee brings forward for the benefit of Parliament and for good governance. But can I ask, on the back of what you've been saying today and acknowledging the range of legal necessities that the Scottish Government has to recognise, is it overarching in this instance that it's really the immunisation, it's the scientific, it's the health imperatives that come first and foremost for the Scottish Government, which then leads to the extensions which we've been talking about here, the potential necessity during the 6 months extension that we might have to come back again to look at what might be another hopefully not, eruption of COVID. And that's the reason as to why this six-month extension is being looked at.
I understand entirely why people want to move on and want to move on from COVID. I completely understand that. But I'm not sure if I've made this point to this committee. I may have done. Not only is it difficult to remember what days of the week it is, it's difficult to remember where you've said particular things. But if I go back to late November, the Cabinet had a discussion on a Tuesday late in November, I can't remember the dates, at which generally I would say we came to the view that things were quite benign. We thought that we'd be looking forward to a fairly stable Christmas and there'd be, you know, things were on the up. By the Thursday afternoon, Michael Matheson had been requested to join a call with United Kingdom government ministers and their colleagues in the other devolved governments to consider travel restrictions on southern African countries because of Omicron. And we received briefings about the spread, the transmissibility of Omicron. And so within 48 hours, we had gone from a view which was things are benign and we're on for a stable approach to Christmas to having to contemplate what measures were necessary to try to prevent transmissibility. And indeed, in retrospect, looking in the rear mirror, the example of an outbreak of COVID which came the closest to overtopping our National Health Service. So all the stuff up until November had been challenging, but it hadn't come close. It hadn't come as close as Omicron to overtopping the National Health Service. And the reason why Omicron came close was because of the degree of transmissibility, the volume of infection, the number of hospitalisations, and the impact on staff availability. That combination we hadn't faced in previous variants. So I simply say that to the committee to indicate that, you know, I hope that over the next 6 months, we have six benign months ahead of us in relation to COVID. But I can't sit here with certainty and say that to the committee. I'm simply trying to put in place the statutory arrangements to ensure that the government can act fast. Now, there is going to be a public inquiry into COVID and the handling of COVID. One of the first issues that Lady Poole's inquiry will consider is preparations for the pandemic. And I think, you know, I have to make judgments about, on a constant basis, about how prepared are we as a government and as a country for certain eventualities. That's my ultimate responsibility for resilience. So the legislation that's brought forward to the committee and to Parliament on this question is about making sure that we have the necessary preparations in place to deal with the situation as we may face it. Hopefully it doesn't happen, but it's there to be undertaken.
Thank you.
Mr. Simpson.
Thanks again, Convener. Mr. Swinney, I just want to talk about the other instrument that you've come in to speak about. And that relates to powers that councils have. And they have powers over premises, events and public outdoor spaces. Can you explain what these powers actually are and why, given that you're about to remove pretty much all of the restrictions on our daily lives? Are going, face coverings will be the final one. Why on earth councils would require to hang on to these powers for another 6 months?
Essentially to provide the capacity to deal with outbreak management would be my, I think, the most appropriate way to express this. So we saw in the course of the pandemic, as the pandemic began, if we go back to 2020, as we saw its development, there were certain outbreaks that fueled the spread of the pandemic. And what we were trying to do in the early part of the handling of the pandemic was to isolate those as much as we possibly could do. Some of them were about workplaces, some of them were about venues, some of them were about localities. And we're trying to take measures which would essentially try to insulate insulate the rest of the country from those outbreaks to avoid communal spread. And local authority powers and actions, particularly in the work that we do along with environmental health officers, for example, are critical to enabling that to be the case.
This instrument gives councils a power over public outdoor spaces. So if we could describe that as possibly parks, why would councils need powers to do anything in public outdoor spaces for the next 6 months?
Because there may be particular areas that we have to identify as being related to outbreaks, or we may have to restrict access if we're trying to prevent the spread of the virus in the way that we had to do, regrettably, at stages in the pandemic. But I think the crucial point is, do we, and we're going to come back to this time and time again, do we want to have a statute book that is fit to handle circumstances, or do we want to have to do it? And Mr. Sweeney is quite fairly saying to me, we need to have a process of thinking through what we need to do in certain circumstances. And I'm simply saying, well, based on the experience we've had, do we want to prepare the statute book for that, or do we not? That's the crucial point here.
Well, another crucial point is, do you want to cede powers to government or councils that are emergency powers, and do you want them to become the norm?
But government and local authorities in the statute book just now have a whole range of different emergency powers given to us by Parliament, exercised only when there is a justification for exercising them. And this is no different.
So if they have that range of powers, why do they need these?
No, I mean in general, in life, in general, in other circumstances. We've got plenty of powers that we can use in emergency situations. But when it comes to the handling of a pandemic of this nature, we found out, frankly, the hard way, that the statute book was not equipped to handle these things. And I'm now trying to remedy that. Now, Parliament will have the opportunity. It's got the opportunity in these regulations to either accept them or to reject them. And Parliament will have the opportunity in the legislation that I'm bringing forward to consider whether or not it is proportionate to and appropriate to ensure that our statute book has these provisions. And that's not to say these powers are getting exercised every day of the week, because they're not. They've got to have particular justification for them to be used in these circumstances. But Parliament has to consider whether or not those powers should be there, should they be required.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Simpson. Do we have any further questions for the Deputy First Minister? No. Okay. So, with that, Deputy First Minister and officials, thank you very much for coming to the committee this morning. And I will suspend the meeting briefly to allow the Cabinet Secretary and officials to leave the table and the room. Thank you. Moving to agenda item number 3, we're considering instruments subject to the made affirmative procedure. The first is SSI 2022-40, the Coronavirus Act 2020, alteration of expiry date, Scotland Regulations 2022. As well as the evidence session with the Deputy First Minister just now, the committee had previously exchanged written correspondence with the Scottish Government. This can be read in paper 1 for this meeting and led to the Scottish Government revising its policy note. Do members wish to make any further comments on the regulations?
Yeah.
Mr. Simpson.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think we had a very, very useful session with the Deputy First Minister there. So in relation to this instrument, it clearly deals with a number of areas. I can be content with some of them, but there's one of them that I'm really not comfortable with, and that is the power to close student accommodation and boarding accommodation. As we heard during the discussion earlier, that's a power that has never been used during the entire pandemic. The government's relied on guidance. So I cannot see any justification for hanging on to this power for another 6 months. I don't think Mr. Swinney made a compelling argument for that. I think if you've had a power, you've not used it during the height of the pandemic, and we're in a much better place now than we were, than we have been, then I cannot see any justification for hanging on to that power, which was an emergency power. So on that basis, I think this actually throws up the issue of where we as parliamentarians are asked to approve instruments which contain, you know, a number of provisions, some of which we like, some of which we don't like, and I think there needs to be some flexibility in the system to allow us more to sort of pick and choose. And if that was able to be reported to the lead committee, that would be useful. So on the basis that I don't like one of these provisions, convener, I'll be voting against it. But I would much rather have the ability to pick them off, if you like. But that's not available to us. So unfortunately, on that basis, I'll vote against.
OK, thank you, Mr. Simpson. Do other members wish to make any comments? Mr. Hoy?
Thank you, Convener. Just to, in part, echo what Mr. Simpson said, but also just maybe to draw attention to the Deputy First Minister's response in relation to why these powers and how they come to, or why these powers need to be extended and how they come to a decision on the basis of it being necessary and proportionate. I thought he gave a very full response in relation to that, but at the end of the day, he said it all comes down to the judgment of the Minister at the end of the day. And I think in light of the fact that the particular provision that Mr. Simpson has referenced in relation to boarding accommodation hasn't been used throughout the height of the pandemic and at the most extreme periods, then I think maybe it does fail that test of being necessary. And on that basis, I think I'd be minded to vote against as well.
OK, thank you, Mr. Hoy. Any other colleagues? Mr. Kidd.
Yep, and thank you. I've listened to what's been said, and I can sort of understand an element of it. At the same time, I'm very worried about throwing babies out with bathwater. There's a lot of stuff here which is absolutely very necessary going forward, and I would be voting in favour of keeping.
OK, thank you. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I note the concerns raised by colleagues on the committee and do have some sympathies with superfluous provisions that are highly unlikely to be utilised, and therefore there are questions of whether they're essential to be included in the SSI. And I think that opens up a wider discussion about quality assurance and legislation like this, which we have to consider, bearing in mind the committee's report recently. However, I don't, on the balance of probabilities, think it's a major risk to permitting this to continue for another 6 months.
Okay, thank you. Okay, with that, I will pose the question, is the committee content with the instrument? No. Okay, so it appears that we will have a division on this instrument. I'll ask members to raise their hands. whether they wish to make no recommendations in relation to the instrument. The three options are to agree, to not agree, and also to abstain. So could all members who agree with the instrument please raise your hands. Thank you. Could all members who do not agree please raise your hands. Thank you. And just for the record, could all members who wish to abstain please raise your hands. So the thank you. If so, the vote was 3 votes for and 2 votes against. So with that, the committee therefore is agreed. However, members' concerns about the instrument that have been expressed on the record, and obviously there will be a report published and sent to the lead committee, and the concerns will be noted in the report. Also, under this agenda item, no points have been raised on SSI 2022-74. That's the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements of Scotland, Amendment Number 5, Regulations 2022. Do members wish to make any further comments on these regulations? No. Is the committee content with this instrument? Thank you. Under agenda item number 4, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft, health protection, coronavirus restrictions, directions by local authorities, Scotland Amendment and Regulations 2022. Given the evidence heard earlier from Mr Swinney in relation to these regulations, do members have any comments to make on this instrument? Mr Simpson.
Just a brief comment, convener. As we heard earlier, this instrument extends the powers given to councils for another 6 months in relation to premises, events and public outdoor spaces. Given where we are with the health situation, I cannot see a justification for councils hanging on to these particular powers for another 6 months. And in those circumstances, I'll be voting no.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments from colleagues? No? Okay. With that, is the committee content with this instrument? Okay. So it appears we will have a division on the instrument. I'll ask members to raise their hands whether they wish to make no recommendations in relation to the instrument. The three options are to agree, to not agree, or to abstain. So could all members who agree please raise your hands? Thank you. Could all members who do not agree please raise your hands? Thank you. And there are no abstentions. Okay. So the vote was 3 for and 2 against. The committee is therefore agreed. However, members' concerns about the instrument have been expressed and noted in the record, and also when the report is published, they will be noted in the report. Also, under this item, no points have been raised on the following draft instruments. The Equality Act 2010, Specific Duties, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. The Coronavirus Scotland Act's Amendment of Expiry Dates, Regulation 2022. And the Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2022. Is the committee content with these instruments? Thank you. Under agenda item number 5, we're considering instruments subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2022, 47, 49, 52 and 64. Do members have any comments to make on any of these instruments? Okay. So is the committee content with these instruments? Thank you. And with that, I will move the committee into private.